Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Beyond Beautiful, using the power of your mind and aesthetic breakthroughs to look naturally young and radiant, by Doris Day, M.D., narrated by Randye, Kaye. On a day when the wind is perfect, the sail just needs to open and the world is full of beauty. Today is such a day. Rumi. Introduction. Appearance is anything but superficial. Think about the days when you feel you're most beautiful. What do you love about those days, and when does that beautiful feeling start? Is it with a caress of your soft, smooth skin when you first wake up? Receiving a kind word from a friend, partner, or even stranger? Or being pleased by your reflection in the mirror? This book is about improving your most important relationship, the one with yourself, in order to be your radiant best and enhance your presence in the world. To achieve these things, you must not think of the mind-body-skin connection as the meeting of three separate entities. Rather, consider that your mind, body, and skin are one and the same. This means that what you see, whether in the mirror in front of you or in your mind's eye, is a reflection of the natural condition of your skin combined with the effects of specific life events and stressors. When you look tired, sad, or old, you have a rash, an acne breakout, or flare-up of psoriasis, pay close attention. Your skin is also transmitting information about what's going on physically and emotionally. Some stress is heuristic and can work to protect your skin, your body, and your mind, but in many cases, it triggers a negative cycle that accelerates aging. It is only through understanding and properly addressing the source of our stress that we achieve lasting results, optimal health, and true beauty. It's not as hard as you might think, and I will guide you through, step by step, on your personal journey. I like to think of myself as a skin whisperer, helping to reveal and enhance skin's beauty by identifying and addressing what's aging it or causing it to look anything less than its healthiest and most radiant. I will teach you how to respond to this information, as well as show you the best ways to treat various skin conditions so you can always be your healthiest, feel your most beautiful, and look your very best. I've been a board-certified dermatologist for more than 20 years, treating everyone from kids and busy moms and dads to celebrities, models, and CEOs. I've also worked in a research lab at New York University and have helped develop several skincare lines for major brands, including Estee Lauder Company. I take health, skincare, and beauty very seriously, and the radical idea fueling my approach is that by being aware of every aspect of our lives, genetics and internal and external stressors, we can change our skin and live the best lives possible. This belief, as well as my studies of philosophy and the humanities, has informed my years of medical practice, journalistic endeavors, and medical research to the acclaim of both my patients and peers. My techniques are based on the latest scientific understanding of how we age and combine the most cutting-edge, non-surgical treatments with the best ingredients and supplements to help you age beautifully. You should not consider having another treatment or procedure or buying another product before listening to this book. In addition to being something of a medical detective, unearthing the true nature of my patients' health from the clues their bodies provide, I also consider myself a doctor of self-esteem. Sheryl Sandberg, the CEO of Facebook, advised women to lean in the workplace. Well, I'm challenging you to dive in and examine all aspects of your life to understand how they equally contribute to your body and your skin's reflection of you. The results of my treatments have been life-changing for my patients, and now you can experience the same results. Throughout this book, I will show you how to unlock the power of the mind-body-skin connection for yourself, explain the best treatments available, and explore what the future of skincare and beauty holds. I'll share many fascinating stories of patients who have experienced and beautifully overcome many of the same problems you may be experiencing right now. If the advice I gave them helps you too, I will have done my job. I know many of you listening to this book are searching for the best and most lasting ways to prevent aging, recapture your youth, or freeze time. You are not alone. In a 2017 consumer survey of over 7,300 people done by the American Society for Dermatologic Surgery, nearly 7 in 10 people surveyed said they were considering a cosmetic procedure. The top three reasons given were, 1, I want to feel more confident, 2, I want to look as young as I feel, and 3, I want to appear more attractive. Substantial advances have been made that put reversing and even preventing much of the aging process well within reach of the average American. We can save the skin from damage, control and complement the repair of existing damage, and improve strength, resilience, tone, and clarity. One method uses the power of non-surgical approaches to help you look and feel your best, what I call syringe therapy. Used correctly, it has great potential to help you age beautifully and look more like the way you feel inside. But used indiscreetly as a weapon against aging, in an attempt to wipe out any hint of a line, wrinkle, or hollow, it can leave you looking older and artificial. Sadly, when I look around, I'm struck by obvious cosmetic mistakes, from overfilled lips and cheeks to clearly missed areas that leave the face looking unbalanced and done. I call that syringe therapy gone wrong. There are several reasons why a specific treatment may fail. The first is a lack of knowledge. This reason is two-part. On the one hand, science still gives us only a partial understanding of all the processes that age us. On the other hand, is the fact that you can optimize but cannot change your genetics. This means you need to alter your perspective, learning to examine your beauty with the same fine-tooth comb you use to scrutinize your flaws. The third reason treatments fail is the emotional component. This is problematic when the way we see ourselves drives us to change our features, as if changing them alone will change our lives and how we feel about our lives. And finally, there's ineptitude. Unfortunately, there's always someone who's willing to forego basic aesthetic principles and add a little or a lot here or there, whether or not you need it to make a buck. In the hands of these practitioners, the patient ends up looking like a caricature of themselves, and in the worst case, entirely unlike the original versions of themselves. I'm here to help you accomplish your aesthetic goals successfully, safely, and effectively. Do your homework, which you are doing right now by listening to this book. You should research the experience and training of your physician, get recommendations from friends and other doctors you trust, and most importantly, don't cut corners. It is very important to see a trained aesthetic physician, such as a dermatologist or a plastic surgeon, rather than shop for the best price for treatment. It takes years to learn the art of rejuvenation and continued study to hone the skills. The products themselves do not create the results, just as fabric does not magically fall into place as haute couture fashion on its own. Rather, just as gifted designers craft fabric to fit your body perfectly, we use our tools of fillers and devices to reflate, restore, and enhance your most natural and beautiful self. A central theme of this book, which I just mentioned, is that there is an emotional component to the way we see ourselves, which drives our desire to change our features, as if altering them will also transform our lives. An excellent example of this came from a woman named Deborah, who called my radio show, The Dermatology Show, on Dr. Radio, asking about a Botox cosmetic treatment for her son, Jim. She told me and my listeners that Jim was 23, and she casually asked about treatment options to help raise his drooping brows, which she said were negatively affecting his self-esteem. My guest expert, a plastic surgeon, gave a thoughtful account of all the ways the brows could be lifted through injections of Botox cosmetic, undergoing a surgical brow lift, and with devices. I coaxed a little more background information from Deborah. I hope to uncover the internal catalyst driving her son's, and maybe even her own, particular concern. I asked Deborah if the appearance of her son's eyebrows had been present since birth, if there was a trauma that had coincided with his brows beginning to droop, and how much her son really minded the look of his brows versus her minding it. She surprised me by replying that the noticeable drooping of her son's brows was present at birth, and the issue was that it made him look like his dad. That caught me off guard and required further discussion in a direction that was new for me, too. Upon my further gentle questioning, she told me, with great bitterness in her voice, that she had divorced her husband when their son was 2. Her husband had since been absent, as well as in and out of incarceration. The picture started to come into focus. It was no wonder this young man was concerned about looking like his father. He may have felt that any resemblance to his dad would make him act like his dad. And given the feelings his mom seemed to have about her ex-husband, as suggested in the tone of her voice, he may also have harbored concern that his appearance could alienate him from her. My guest and I encouraged Deborah to consider how her feelings and her son's fears might be bigger than the physical concern. As we spoke, she became increasingly animated, discovering out loud her husband's impact on her son and how she might have been complicit in allowing her son to feel bad about his features. I could hear the tears in her voice as she recalled the suffering her son had experienced and as she understood the better path for her son, and even herself, would be to talk about their experience so that, rather than changing his features, they could change what they symbolized. She was so happy they hadn't pursued treatment for the brows before she called into the show, because a purely physical treatment would not have addressed the underlying issue. Jim's brow issue illustrates the importance of understanding that looks and personal relationships are deeply reflective of each other. The skin can evoke the glow of love, the burning redness of anger, or the calm serenity of acceptance. As we go along, we'll dig deeper into this connection. I will show you how to identify negative emotions and their potential effects on your appearance. And I'll highlight and help redirect you down the path so you can see and feel the wonderful impact your healthy relationships have on how you look. And you? When will you begin that long journey into yourself? Rumi. How you perceive your appearance is not solely about what's external. Before you have a cosmetic treatment or another treatment or procedure, I want you to consider that there is an internal component driving what you would like to change about your looks. Once you acknowledge it, you'll be able to maximize the benefits of your treatment and enhance your unique natural beauty with longer-lasting results. Stressed out or stressed for success? We all have stress, whether it's at home, at work, or in our social lives. It's an inevitable part of living and not always necessarily negative. Sometimes stress is a natural result of pushing ourselves out of our comfort zone so we can grow and improve in our lives and the lives of those around us. However, recognizing the stressors and how we handle them is what makes all the difference and affects us in ways that we need to understand. Since ancient times, we have used the fight-or-flight response, which produces several hormones, including cortisol, in situations of danger. The fact is, you don't actually have to be threatened to feel that you are. The mind is a powerful tool that can help us handle myriad situations and control our body's response to nearly everything we are exposed to. Over our lifetime, we build millions of memories that are stored in different parts of our brain, immune system, and other organs. These memories affect, for better or for worse, how we respond to situations. What I will help you discern is the direct connection between a particular stressor and the visible physical reaction to it. It's no accident that you are breaking out in sweat, rash, acne, or hives, or shedding hair. Ask yourself, why is my stress showing up where it is and in the way it is? Why is it showing up now? Understanding the mind-body-skin connection involves getting to the source of your skin problems and finding the best ways to treat it, along with identifying the best treatments available to help the condition clear as quickly as possible. I'm going to show you how your self-image and specific skin concerns do not form by accident. These issues are deeply rooted. You'll learn how to decipher what your skin ailments really mean, from hair loss and rashes around the eyes, mouth, or hands, to acne, to how you see yourself aging. I'll also help you employ a mindful approach to healing to extend the results of any treatments and help you avoid future recurrences of problems. And I'll share practical ways anyone can improve their look, for example, with facial yoga exercises to tone, tighten, and energize your skin. I'll also explain how exercise and nutrition can give your skin that healthy glow. Your skin is all revealing, and beautiful, radiant skin equates with healthy skin that is well cared for. You might find that you have an easier time developing and maintaining great skin than others because of genetics, but the better care you take of those genes, the more it will show in your skin. As we embark upon this journey together, here's my advice on four basic aspects of skincare anyone can follow. Go ahead and give these a try as you continue to listen to discover more about how to be beyond beautiful. Wash. This is the most important step in your beauty and skincare routine. If you don't cleanse, the makeup, pollution, and grime left on your skin can become toxic and aging. I prefer a cleansing brush over using your hands and soap and water. My two favorites are the Olay Pro X Microdermabrasion Kit, which comes with a cleaning brush and is available at any drugstore, and the Clarisonic line of facial cleansing brushes. Exfoliate. Your skin naturally exfoliates itself, but can always use a little help. Exfoliating has been around since ancient times and should be performed regularly on both your face and your body. You can use a chemical exfoliator like an alpha hydroxy or beta hydroxy acid, or you might choose to physically exfoliate using a scrub or a device. How often you need to exfoliate depends on your skin, the time of year, and the other treatments you're using. Overdoing it will strip your skin and leave it dry and sensitive, so I'll help you understand what's best for your skin. Hydrate. One of the most important functions of the skin and essential to life itself is water balance. When your body is dehydrated, one of the first places it shows is in your skin. This is due to loss of water from the deeper layers of the skin, not just the outer layers. When your skin is dehydrated, it loses its firmness, starts to sag, and even looks more wrinkled. In this case, you need to hydrate from the inside as well as outside. I have many patients with oily skin that is also dehydrated. They need to improve their water balance, but do not need an occlusive moisturizer that will block pores and worsen their acne. Great hydrators include ingredients like hyaluronic, lactic, and phytic acids. These help deliver and hold water in the skin without being occlusive. These acids help to naturally balance the water and oil in the skin, which helps your skin look its best and stay on its best behavior. Sun protection. This is about prevention. It's always easier to prevent damage than it is to fix it after the fact. No one is excluded from needing sun protection. No matter your skin color or how much time you spend in the sun, everyone needs sun protection and to be sun smart every day year round. I'll talk about this a lot more all the way through the book, but you heard it here first. The ultimate goal is to age gracefully, not helplessly. This is your best chance to take optimal care of your genetic gifts to age naturally and beautifully. I want to help boost your self-image so you can put your best face forward and live up to your genetic potential. Whatever you decide to do next, please don't feel guilty about wanting to take care of yourself. It doesn't mean you're any less serious about or devoted to your other life obligations. After you listen to this book, the next time you look in the mirror, you'll understand the real reasons for what you see and how to fix what you want to improve. The most important way for you to attain the look you want will be by digging deeper while also addressing the surface changes to your skin. And remember, you didn't get here overnight, so you don't need to and probably won't be able to fix it overnight. Natural and beautiful results take time, but are worth it and will last because they are part of a complete package called you. My story. I have found the paradox that if you love until it hurts, there can be no more hurt, only more love. Mother Teresa. Everyone has a story, or several stories, good and bad, that affects their lives in powerful ways. Here are two of mine. At the age of 16, my sister Adrienne died. She was also my best friend and, in many ways, my responsibility, even if I was only 18 months older. I was the elder sister, but I saw her as prettier, way more self-assured, and wise beyond either of our years. Growing up, we shared everything: a room, our clothes, our toys, our records, and our friends. We were inseparable, and while we had the usual sisterly spats, at night we often wound up in the same bed, talking, laughing, and snuggling until we fell asleep. One day, when she was nearly 14, she showed me a firm lump in her left bikini fold. She said, "Don't tell anyone." I was frightened by what I saw and could sense that something was clearly wrong, but she made it clear that this was to be our secret. So I kept my word and told no one. I was too young and innocent to know how sick she was, and never for a moment thought it could kill her. Over the next few months, she continued to lose weight and experience unexplained fevers, and the lump continued to grow to the point where it was no longer possible to hide from our parents, who immediately took her to the doctors. Within a week, the diagnosis of advanced non-Hodgkin's lymphoma was made. She spent most of the next 6 months in the hospital, where she suffered through agonizing round after round of the most powerful chemotherapy available and high-dose radiation to avoid the spread of cancer to her brain. The result was waves of nausea, intense and unrelenting pain, both from the cancer spreading and from the treatments and tests that go along with it. Organ failure, swelling of her body almost beyond recognition, and all to no avail. One of the moments that stand out to me occurred early in her treatment. I remember going with her to buy a wig for when her hair would fall out from the treatments. Her hair was her pride and joy. It was long and beautiful, and she took great care of it her whole life. She broke down in tears when she saw it coming out in clumps. It caused her as much pain and agony as any treatment she had to endure, and to this day it still brings tears to my eyes to think of how sad it made her. I treat hair loss in my practice, and I do my best to help anyone else in that same predicament from any cause of hair loss. She was wise, way beyond her years, and her suffering through all the treatments, only to die in the end, was a part of her life that I would need years and years to understand and come to terms with. Losing someone you love takes enormous mental effort and persistence to pry a space between wishing there was a way to erase their suffering and bring them back, and to let the good memories in and to move forward. Over the years, I continued on my own life journey and tried to mask the pain I felt, but it was there. And it showed through in its own way, over and over, through a 50-pound weight gain that was apparent to the world, and in a more subtle but powerful way I saw in my eyes. The most obvious and clear expression of sadness is tears, but I had none. I felt guilty and numb and scared, and I wondered if I was even capable of love, if I wasn't capable of shedding a tear over the suffering and loss of my dear sister. Secretly, I also wanted to look older than my years. I know it seems like a strange thing for a young person to wish for, but at the time, I thought that wisdom came with age, and it would help me understand what had happened and make it less painful. I wanted to see things differently, and I wanted my lids so heavy they would cover my eyes and my guilt at not being able to save my sister or protect her from harm. Looking back, I know it's because I didn't want anyone else to see how I had failed my sister, failed to keep her safe from harm, failed to support her, to be there for her as she suffered, because I was afraid of what I saw. I now realize these were fears based on the fantasy that I had control over what happened, but I didn't accept this until much later in life. When I finally hit my rock bottom of despair, 50 pounds heavier and feeling totally alone in the world, I realized I had a choice. I could keep going as I was, lonely, uncomfortably heavy and sad, or I could do something different. It was time to rise above the hurt and negativity and dedicate my life to something positive, to educating and healing others. My mission became to honor my sister's memory by doing anything I could to help others see the good in any circumstance, even if there was no good in it at all, starting with themselves. As an English major at Barnard College, I took courses in literature and philosophy, which helped save my life and shape my future. My healers were my professors and great writers and thinkers, like Kant, Nietzsche, Schopenhauer, Kafka, Mann, Shakespeare, Chaucer, and so many others who portrayed humanity, gave purpose to suffering, and helped me to climb out of my abyss. I then went on to become a medical journalist, at least partly so I could share my sister's amazing story of strength and dignity, and write about hospice care, advocate for quality of life over longevity for its own sake, and explain how illness and medical treatment should involve the entire family, including the individual patient, even if they are a child. I also wanted to contribute to changing medical care by becoming a doctor and being my patient's strongest advocate and protector in any way I could. My love of medicine was also passed on to me at an early age by my father, who was an anesthesiologist. He was a healer and an educator, in addition to being a poet and a wonderful singer. He started practicing medicine during the 1950s and was far ahead of his time regarding his understanding of health, diet, and even skin care. My dad had seen his older sisters age radically at a relatively young age from sun exposure. He was an advocate of using sunscreen and physical sun protection long before it became fashionable. He made sure I never purposely tanned. He also understood the power of nutrition. He always told me, never eat after 8 p.m. And science has finally caught up with him. Studies show that if you do all your daily eating within a 12-hour window, say between 8 a.m. and 8 p.m., you have a better chance of losing weight and staying healthy than if you consume the same number of calories over 24 hours. He also knew the power of exercise and took daily 8 to 10-mile walks. My dad loved his work and loved sharing his knowledge and seeing the difference that made in others. Sometimes people didn't want to hear that they needed to lose weight or quit smoking, but he found a way to reach them. He taught me to respect the inextricable connectivity among the mind, body, and soul. As a teenager helping out in his office, I remember his saying, "You can't just count on the textbooks. Anyone can learn the science. You have to learn how to take care of the person in front of you. Some people are anxious, and you need to talk to them about their family and get to know them. They have to trust and have confidence in you so you can take the best care of them with as little medication as possible." The confidence and calm he instilled in his patients just by talking and asking questions is something I incorporate into my own practice. One of the most important lessons my father taught me was how to be a better doctor by treating the whole person. I can help others heal by encouraging them to better understand themselves and learn how to live in the moment. The credo that I follow is, for every regret, you should do 10 things differently going forward so that regret becomes a blessing. And for all my regrets about not being there for Adrienne in the way I wanted to be and wished I could have been, I can open my eyes, now genuinely older and wiser, able to do so many things differently based on what I've learned and experienced, and with gratitude for having had her in my life. My father taught me the most important lesson in the last weeks of his life. On February 12, 2013, at the age of 91, he was out on one of his daily walks around New York, the city he loved, when he was struck by an SUV that had lost control and swerved up onto the sidewalk and pinned him to the wall near the entrance of Saks Fifth Avenue on Fifth Avenue and 50th Street at 11 a.m. on a Tuesday morning. People posted pictures on Facebook of the scene with comments saying one person was hit and killed. None of us had any idea it was my dad or that the reports were wrong and he was still alive. I got to the ER just as Dad suddenly and rapidly decompensated. He was surrounded by doctors and residents frantically working to resuscitate him. He was dying. I was shocked to see him in such a bad state, since just shortly before, I had been told he was under observation, alert, and stable. I ran to his side, begged, pleaded with him, and outright sobbed while telling him over and over again, "I love you. I need you. You can't die like this. Not now. I still have so much to learn from you." I was desperate for him to hear me say those words and to hear me thank him for all he had done for me before he died. I knew it meant as much to him as it did to me. The doctors were kind enough to let me stay. They could see Dad was responding to me. His pressure started to come back up, and he came back to life. He survived another 7 weeks and was fortunate to have suffered only a minor stroke and no internal injuries. But ultimately, his 91-year-old body could not overcome the trauma of all the broken bones, stress, and complications of life in an ICU, even though he was in otherwise excellent health. In those 7 weeks, my mom never left his side. My brother and our spouses and children frequently came to visit. I was there every day on rounds helping to oversee his care, ultimately making the choice to accept hospice care to help him pass in peace, knowing how much he was loved and would be missed. The greatest gift during this time was being able to tell him thank you and I love you and hearing him tell me he was proud of me and that he loved me. I was so grateful to be able to take care of him and not feel helpless as I had with my sister. I could help direct his care and make sure he was as comfortable as possible. He taught me about dying with dignity and that it is merely a transition, not an end. He told me I saved him, and he said his goodbyes to everyone before continuing on his journey beyond this life. One of my father's proudest moments was when he handed me my diploma at my medical school graduation. He loved that I was a doctor and that I also understood the value of appearance and the impact it had on health. I can still hear so many of my dad's lessons. One of the biggest was him telling me to first be a woman when I was becoming a doctor. He would tell me stories that illustrated the importance of balance and that emphasizing one aspect of life over another was not healthy or fulfilling. He was the ultimate feminist, helping many women become successful in their careers and erasing any thoughts of limits on what they could accomplish. He inspired me in uncountable ways, and his philosophies have impacted who I am, how I treat my patients, and what I believe you can accomplish through this book today. I didn't choose and had no say in what happened to my sister or my dad, but I chose to define my purpose from the experiences. I want to share in this book some of the wisdom I learned from my father and from my own experiences as a woman and as a doctor. Not only will it serve as a roadmap to navigating the best skincare and aesthetic treatments throughout the decades, but it will illustrate a whole new beauty paradigm and serve as your homing beacon and GPS as you go through life. In the 10 years since my first book, I've honed and expanded my skills as a physician specializing in dermatology and internal medicine. I have traveled the country and the world, studying and teaching health and aesthetic vision and treatments to help advance the science and education of my peers and the public on the art of medicine. I have also served on many advisory boards, on the board of directors for the American Society for Dermatologic Surgery, and taught dermatology at NYU Langone Medical Center for 20 years. Beyond Beautiful presents a whole new understanding of rejuvenation and the aging process, and includes information on the latest advancements in aesthetic ingredients and treatments. It will help you decide what is the best course for you and what to expect and ask your doctor before having any treatment done. Chapter 1. Look inside to see your true reflection. And if I asked you to name all the things you love most, how long would it take to name yourself? Unknown. What makes people beautiful and why? Our subconscious brain sees things that our eyes don't. The furrow of a brow, squint of an eye, pucker of the lips, the way we flip our hair, these are all subliminal expressions of our inner self. They affect the way we communicate and the image we convey to the world. People can make a major change, like reshaping their nose, and not be happy. Or they can make the simplest, minute change and be thrilled. So much of what we are taught as cosmetic physicians are the individual mechanics of beauty. But the astute aesthetic physician assesses the face as a global aesthetic rather than a set of lines and wrinkles. We understand that faces have complex angles and multidimensional features to be understood and addressed, and we must decipher the subliminal messages that people convey through their appearance, body language, and the words they use to express how they feel about themselves. My goal is for you to achieve a healthy balance and harmony in all aspects of your well-being. Harnessing the connection between mind, body, and skin will give you control over what you project to the world about yourself through your appearance. The natural look. The changes that occur as we age are multi-level and multifactorial. On the deepest level, changes in bone structure, muscle, and tissue make it impossible to appear 20 when you're 50. This doesn't mean you become less beautiful as you age. It simply means that the balance of your face changes. Beauty at every age has unique value. As you age, you need an overall aesthetic blueprint, not a patchwork of treatments for the best results. I'll give you specific examples of this as we go. Some patients assume that successful treatment means the complete elimination of all lines and wrinkles, and that if they have a line left or can still move their forehead, they have more work to do. Patients have been trained to judge outcomes by these extremes rather than encouraged to see the overall improvement. And because we see so many supersized cheeks, lips, and bodies, and virtually frozen faces, our vision has become distorted. As the travesty of Michael Jackson's unfortunate cosmetic surgeries proved, there will always be a physician, or worse, a non-physician, who is willing to perform a treatment, whether necessary or not, to make money or for other self-aggrandizing purposes. Patients who have too many or the wrong cosmetic procedures end up looking like distorted caricatures of themselves. I want to empower you with the information you need to avoid treatment by an ill-motivated provider. To enhance your radiance, you'll want to seek only an accredited, board-certified expert with the right care. You'll look your best, but everyone will wonder how it's possible that you never change, or they'll tell you that you seem to age backward, and that is a compliment, meaning you still look like you. Take Anne, for example, a once stunning woman in her 50s who visited my office not long ago. Her poise, elegant dress, and expertly applied makeup showed that she was sophisticated and cared about her appearance, and our initial conversation revealed that she had a successful career in finance. She hadn't just broken glass ceilings, she had shattered them. The first thing I noticed about her, however, was that Anne also looked done. She had no visible nasolabial folds. The lines that go from the corner of your nose to the corner of your mouth. Guess what? You're supposed to have them. She had too much filler in her lips and cheeks, which gave her that dreaded chipmunk cheek look. Everything about her screamed overdone. I could see she was not working off an aesthetic blueprint, but was merely overinflating her face like a blown-up balloon to fill every hole and erase every wrinkle. I needed to know how she saw herself so I could best help her reach beauty goals rather than continuing on her current patchwork quilt path of fix-ups. Was she there, I wondered and hoped, to ask me to correct cosmetic treatments gone wrong? On the contrary, Anne wanted more filler. In her highly self-critical view of herself, all she could see in the mirror were lines, wrinkles, and sagging skin. She was so concerned with recapturing her youth and everything she thought came with it that she failed to see the beauty she already possessed. Of course, Anne is not alone. According to a 2011 poll of 2,000 men and women by Allure magazine, a whopping 93% of women say the pressure to look young today is greater than ever. One reason is that women tend to compare themselves to the idealized and photoshopped versions of models they see in magazines, the movies, and on TV and online. When we look in the mirror and see two chins instead of one, or worry lines between our brows, we'll address those later, we feel our youth and attractiveness slipping away. What we don't see is how the changes that happen over time can actually add to our beauty rather than diminish it. I want you to get to a place where you can see your own beauty, not just the flaws. If you see only your flaws, don't expect anyone else to see your beauty. This is what I showed Anne and what I will teach you too. There's no way to rewind time. I am in no way against aging, and I object to the term anti-aging with all my being. But so much of what we dermatologists see is not about time, but how it has been spent. Such as those days or years of baking in the sun with reflectors and baby oil, or the many visits to the tanning salon. Fortunately, there are outstanding treatments to help prevent damage, slow the aging process, and restore youthfulness. In my consultation with Anne, I sought to learn more about her, why she chose to come to me, and why at that particular time. She revealed that her husband had left her without warning for a woman who was 20 years younger. That had devastated her. She remarked that nearly 5 years later, she was still in mourning, feeling as though she had lost her best friend. She came to see me because her daughter's wedding was coming up and her ex-husband would be attending with his new wife. Naturally, she wanted to look younger for the encounter. The more we talked, the more I sensed her sadness and despair. She had gotten married right out of college and had been with her husband for more than 2 decades. Even worse, she believed her husband would take her back if she only looked younger, as if someone who would trade her in for a younger woman was a catch. I reminded her of all she had accomplished and that no one could take away her value or diminish her success. When she first walked in my door, she couldn't see how remarkable she was. She saw only her flaws and what she felt she lacked, which in her mind was youth. I knew the best way to help her was not only with the aesthetic treatments I could use to rejuvenate her, but also to help her see her true beauty, both inside and out. I convinced her to let me use cosmetic treatments to give her more natural proportions, more reflective of her real beauty. To her great credit, she followed my treatment plan without complaint. I had, as my father had taught me, earned her trust. While performing these cosmetic procedures, to best help Anne, I also channeled my inner Joel Osteen, the televangelist. I encouraged her to focus on what lay ahead in her life rather than lament what she felt she had lost from her past. I shared with her what I'd heard Joel say about a woman he had met who had also suffered abandonment. She really didn't need him. She had better things in store for her. I told her, "That person who left you, they are a weed. Quit watering the weed. Stop feeding your hurt. Feed your future. Feed your destiny. It will make up for the wrongs." Anne had been so busy feeling hurt and loss, she hadn't stopped to think about how special and wonderful she was, how much life she had left to live. But as time went on, she became more involved in activities that interested her, and she met someone very special who appreciated her. She later told me she wouldn't take her ex back if he begged. Her life began to come back into focus, and she liked what she saw. When Anne went to the wedding, she felt radiant and confident, and she enjoyed dancing the night away afterward. Best of all, because she was no longer filled with negative and distracting feelings about her appearance, she was able to focus on what mattered most, her daughter. Sadly, in my work, I often see how the misguided pursuit of unattainable and unrealistic youth and beauty has led people to miss out on enjoying their most endearing attributes and the best days of their lives. Alternatively, a healthy mind-body-skin connection includes gratitude, a healthy lifestyle, being sun smart, using specific skincare ingredients, and finding the best rejuvenation treatments for you. Once you start loving yourself from the inside out, you'll be able to face the world with a healthier, more beautiful, and more youthful appearance. Write it down. Here's a tip for monitoring your emotions, which can impact the way you look and feel. Start keeping what I call a Facebook journal, where you record your private musings and concerns. Know that less is more in this endeavor. You only need to write a few lines or thoughts. This will help you stick with it over time. You can look back over it every few months to see if you notice a trend or pattern, and in what context, and be better able to understand why you see what you see in yourself and address it in a more lasting way. Grab a pen and write down the following affirmations in your Facebook. Read them to yourself every morning when you get up and every night before you sleep. You might even want to carry them with you as a reminder to treat yourself well.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.